Hello there, and thank you for tuning in to see what the world looks like through atheist eyes. I'm Frank Zindler, the managing editor of American Atheist Press, and I'll be your host for this series of programs that I've prepared for American Atheists Television. Today, I want to share with you the second of my interviews with the atheist philosopher John Loftus. Today, we'll be talking about the philosophical innovation for which he has become famous among atheists and greatly feared by Christian apologists, the outsider test for faith. Today we have back with us the philosopher, the atheist philosopher, John Loftus, who's going to tell us about his philosophical invention. John, welcome back.
Nice to be here.
And I promised in a previous program that we would have a whole program devoted to your philosophical discovery, the outsider test for faith. And so this is going to be it. So everybody get your notebooks out and start taking notes. John published a whole book called The Outsider Test for Faith. And he also has summarized it in some of his other books, including Why I Became an Atheist. And so I'm going to cob a few things out of here as we proceed, as I cross-examine him to get more information about this. But before we get into the details, John, would you please tell our viewers what is the outsider test for faith, and how did you come to discover it?
Well, I came to discover it as I was arguing with Christians on my blog, Debunking Christianity. I think there's nothing more interesting than discussing the ideas that separate us on blogs or, you know, via email or on Facebook, because, you know, you don't know everything, and you learn from others. Even though I was a believer and highly educated in the faith, it's interesting to see things differently on the other side. Somebody once told me that now as a non-believer, I cannot see the truth of Christianity because I was not an insider. And they quoted Bible passages, you know.
Yeah, sure.
So I got to thinking, well, you know what? You know, maybe as an outsider, it's a different perspective. And as an outsider not being a believer, maybe I don't see what you see, you know. And so then I asked the person to consider their own faith from an outsider's perspective. And that took place sometime in February 2006. And from that, there was arguments against it that started coming. And I started answering those arguments. And I found those objections to be, you know, quite lame to say the least.
Yeah.
And so more and more Christians came out against it, and, you know, some philosophers, and they tried to argue against it, and I found all those arguments lame as well. And so they actually helped me in a way.
Sure.
By providing those mm-hmm. types of arguments. Mm-hmm. And so, then I wrote something in my book, and then I, you know, wrote a whole book on the topic.
Sure,
and,
sure.
The outsider test for faith is not something really, truly original, although I did discover it. It's a distinction.
I understand the distinction. Yeah,
yeah, I discovered it on my own, but I would have to say that everybody who's ever looked at a religion from the outside has already, you know, done that.
Yeah,
and there's some Robert Ingersoll talks about looking at faith from an outsider's perspective. So does Thomas Jefferson in a letter he wrote, and even G.K. Chesterton.
Yeah.
Talked in terms of looking at their own faith from an outsider's mm-hmm. perspective. So it's not necessarily original, but I discovered it myself. And,
yeah.
And I find that this test is something that believers just don't do, but they should. And that is to look at their own faith with the perspective as if they, you know, didn't have faith. You know,
yeah.
To look at their own faith as if they were an outsider. Like, just as they look at the Muslim faith from an outsider's perspective
yeah.
or the Hindu faith.
Yeah.
Any number of faiths.
John, you know, this prompts me to point out something really very amazing about this particular show. Of all the thousands of people who are watching this show or will be watching this show, every one of them is an atheist. We have 100% atheist viewership.
True.
Now, some of them don't call themselves atheists, but they all agree with you and me. They don't believe in Isis. They don't believe in Thor. They don't believe in Jupiter or Mercury, the god, of course, or Krishna. And, well, maybe a few of them believe in Krishna, but they, but you know, they're all atheists. Maybe we are slightly better in that we disbelieve in one more deity than most of our viewers.
For the same reasons.
Yeah. And that's it, the outsider.
The lack of sufficient objective evidence. And they're looking for evidence like we are looking at their own religion for the evidence.
There you go.
It's just not there for the same reasons, right?
Yeah, exactly.
You can make a distinction between wide atheists and narrow atheists.
Okay.
I think Matt McCormick...
I got to reduce some more weight.
Matt McCormick wrote about that distinction in his book, Atheism, the Case Against Christ. It's a great book.
Mm-hmm.
And a narrow atheist would be someone who is an atheist but believes, rejects only a select few number of religions.
I see.
But embraces one of them.
Yeah, yeah.
He's narrow, you know.
I see.
A wide atheist would be, in his view, someone who rejects them all for the same reasons. I'm an atheist.
And all things supernatural along with it.
Right.
Well, in your summary book, Why I Became an Atheist, you...
That's actually my magnum opus.
It is.
It contains most everything that you'll read.
It is 536 pages. That qualifies as magnum. Anything over 300, actually.
Okay.
In this book, John lists, he's sort of like Charles Darwin, you know, in Origin of Species. Again and again, Darwin points out possible objections to his theory. And he then examines how the evidence reflects upon these possible objections. And John, I'm happy to say, is following in Darwin's tradition. He says five possible
You praise me
objections.
Too highly.
Five possible objections. So I don't know whether these are hardballs or softballs. Actually, given your degree of analysis of this, these are all softballs. But
they're all lame.
Okay, but anyway, I will throw these five objections at him, and then we'll hear what he says about them. One, it's objected that there are small minorities of people who choose to be Christian theists despite having been born and raised in Muslim countries, which demonstrates that people can escape their culturally adopted faith.
Yeah, now. That's in the reference to the religious diversity.
Right. Yeah, maybe you better say a word about that, because that's
crucial.
The
basis of the outsider test for faith is that, you know, we're all raised as believers in different things. If our parents had told us any number of things, we would have believed them unless we could verify it for ourselves or question it later. So people are raised as Hindus, they're raised as Orthodox Jews, they're raised as snake handlers, Pentecostals, Catholics. They're just raised that way.
Yeah, yeah.
And so they're saying, well, no, there are exceptions. So somebody who might be raised in a Muslim culture might actually become, you know, a Christian. So that's the objection to the religious diversity thesis. Now, it does not do any good to point out there are exceptions. It just doesn't do any good when the overall rule is, if you're raised as a Muslim in a Muslim culture, the odds are extremely high you will be a Muslim, you know, remain a Muslim. So it doesn't do any good to point out that there are exceptions. Now, I have questions whether or not there are exceptions too. Because, you know, it still doesn't undermine the idea that we're raised, or that we accept what we find in our culture, you know, when it comes to faith. If faith is the basis for you believe, then almost anything can be believed. And if you have a mentor in your culture that is different or loving or kind, then you might adopt the religion of that mentor. You know, you might consider it. You might see a good life and say, I want to be like him. So I still think there's a lot of people who, even though they're raised in a certain different culture, who are changed to believe something different because of the same process that took place in how they were raised to begin with. And that is peer pressure, parents, authority figures, and the like. Because I don't think faith has any basis, and so that's why I say that. I know that people might disagree, but exceptions don't don't do anything against the rule.
Yeah.
It doesn't say anything against the rule.
Two, someone may argue that even if religious faiths were 100% correlated with the, quote, accidents of birth, I guess those are your words, this wouldn't invalidate any particular one of them, for it could still be possible that theirs is the correct one after all.
Yeah, it's still possible. I mean, yeah. Anything's possible. a clock with two hands can be right twice every 24 hours.
Wow, I had never heard that before.
You probably said So if you're going to hang your hat on a possibility, anything will do. You know, and I find that Christians will regularly retreat to what's possible rather than what's probable.
What is probable, exactly.
And they will require their faith to be refuted, such to the point where it's impossible before they will ever consider it to be probable.
Yeah.
Which reverses the way you go through.
Sure.
So as long as they can point to a mere possibility, which is what both of these objections actually do, it doesn't do anything to undercut the probabilities or the odds.
It occurs to me that's the thing that biblical apologists do when they try to explain away the contradictions. Well, it's possible that Judas, after he hanged himself, exploded and and so forth.
Yeah, yeah. Any possibility will do it.
Yeah.
And that's really why I'm a white atheist.
Yeah.
I tire of possibilities substituting for probabilities.
Right, right. Three, someone may ask if my argument is self-defeating. Do my cultural conditions overwhelmingly determine my presumption of skepticism? If so, then others don't have much of a reason to adopt the skeptical stance. If not, then why do I think I can transcend culture, but a Christian theist can't?
Well, I think that we're all...
Answer that.
Yeah, I think we're all in the same boat. That's I think that we are part of our culture. We adopt our cultural standards and beliefs in many cases. I think that anthropology has shown us that. And so the question is, why do I think I've transcended my culture? I think that once you realize that we're all in the same boat, that is, as human beings, we tend to adopt our cultural standards and beliefs. Once we realize that, then it does change everything. Because at that point, you can realize from analyzing world history and world beliefs, you can say, you know what, how do I know that my beliefs are true? And at that point, you become skeptical. You know, at that point, you start trusting science. At that point, you look for objective evidence. So you're not so much seeking, you're not so much claiming to transcend your culture. You're asking, why do I have these beliefs? And you're seeking a sound method for knowing that. And the only method would be objective evidence, you know, before I believe something.
So it's cultural influence becoming conscious of itself.
Yes. Yes. And at that point, you know, it's like Plato's analogy of the
cave. In the cave, yes. Yeah.
You look around yourself, and then you find that you have reason to question, and you exit the cave, you know. And you realize you see things different. And the difference is knowing that you're in the cave.
The difference
is that you realize it's just a cave.
That's it, yeah.
And when you realize it's a cave, then at that point, and not until... You can ask yourself, well, why am I, ethnocentric, for instance?
Yeah,
you know,
why
do I accept this religion when all religions are, you know, taught by the same means, that is, on your mama's knees and from your cultural? So then when you realize you're in this same boat, that's when you can actually transcend it, if that's possible.
Yeah, yeah.
But if it's possible, it's going to be done by science. It's going to be done by objective evidence for one belief over the other.
So Plato even got something right once.
Confound those ancients. They've stolen all of our ideas.
Okay. Well, in arguing that one's religious faith is overwhelmingly adopted by when and where someone is born, have I committed the informal genetic fallacy of irrelevance?
Yeah, the genetic fallacy...
Yeah, what is the genetic fallacy?
...is that the origin of a belief is irrelevant to its truth. So you could have a dream, and you can come up with an idea, and the idea itself, I don't care what the idea might be, it might be, that Allah exists, or whatever. The dream itself is irrelevant to whether or not, say, Allah exists. Mm-hmm. And if you say, well, no, that's just a dream, then you're committing that fallacy. You're saying the origin of the idea discredits the idea, and that the idea itself must be defended on its own terms. Well, I do defend it on its own terms. I do show from the biology of belief, I quote Michael Shermer extensively, that the brain is a belief engine. I mean, yes. We just know this.
Yes, yes,
it has agent, to be. We're agency detectors.
Right, right.
And I show that psychology has overwhelmingly shown us that we tend to believe what we were raised to believe, and that we defend that which we prefer to believe over against overwhelming odds. In fact, some studies have shown that when shown contrary evidence that refutes a belief, sometimes people will actually dig their feet in more, not less, because of that belief engine. And from the demographics themselves, you don't find scientists in one part of the globe accepting one theory, and real scientists in another globe accepting a different theory.
Yeah.
But you do find that with religion. You'll find Hindus, gravitate here, Buddhists there, as partly, I think, due to the conquests of history and how armed conflicts settled territorial disputes, and with them came religion.
Yeah,
right. But you don't find that with science, real science, not self-replicating science.
Yeah, science is a self-correcting system, which puts it in a very unique situation as far as human institutions are concerned. And I suppose if there is any systematic procedure that most efficiently, although nothing can be totally effective, but most efficiently avoids the insider influence, it has to be the scientific method.
Right. And additionally, about the genetic fallacy, I'm not actually claiming that any religion is wrong because they were taught on one's mama's knees or in their culture.
I'm
saying that we ought to be skeptical.
Exactly.
Because the same source is that of the other religions.
Yeah, and we have all of these conflicting religions, all of which had the same type of origin. And so how would it be just that this one alone just happens to have that same origin, but this is the correct one?
Same origin, right?
Yeah, same origin, but this is the only correct one out of millions. Five, our final objection. One final similar objection asks whether this is all circular. Have I merely chosen a different metaphysical belief system based upon different cultural factors?
Well, I'm actually one who would... I can actually accept that. And I think that if they accepted that, then they would be skeptics like me. Because we have to question how we are raised. We have to learn to grow up as adults. We have to say to ourselves, okay, now this is what we are taught to believe, and so we need to be skeptics. And the conclusion from that is, I'm not going to accept anything that science doesn't, provide some objective evidence for, given the subjectivity of religions themselves.
Yeah.
So how I've chosen things is because of the morass of how others do. And knowing that I'm in that same boat, the only alternative for an adult is to say, you know what, maybe I do, maybe I have, and so I should be skeptical. And the only alternative to faith would be evidence. You have to have some evidence, strong, objective, concrete evidence if possible, and if not, I'm going to either suspend judgment or I'm just going to reject it. So if this is the case, and if we're all in the same boat, if as human beings we're all in the same boat, that we adopt our cultural preferences, and even if you were raised as an atheist and in an atheist country,
absolutely.
And you adopt those cultural influences, then you should still question, you should still be skeptical, you should still seek evidence, you should sufficient evidence is what I was looking for. And so I can readily accept that and still say it doesn't change anything.
Exactly. Okay. Test all things. I think on that note, we will bring a close to this particular interview with John Loftus. We have lots more things that I want to ask him about, and I'm sure that you will want to see also. But for now, that's today's interview.
Thank you so much.
Thanks for tuning in.